favored springtime activity? Feel free to use the sign-in sheet in the chat. Next. Great, so tonight we are going to share an overview about the Carousel House Rebuild Project. We have engaged stakeholders a number of times, so we'll definitely share with you what we've learned in those design engagements. We'll share some project resources, and also we'll engage you in a community-driven draft design process. So tonight you'll be breaking out into rooms where you'll be intimately engaged in a conversation with some of the Rebuild team members. And so to get us started, just want to share with you some meeting ground rules. We do ask that you keep your microphone muted throughout the presentation. And at the end of the presentation, you may unmute and speak to share your thoughts and questions. We also want you to feel free to use the chat while we are presenting to ask any questions or share ideas that you might have. Your mute button is on the left, lower left-hand side of the screen, and the chat button is in the middle of your bar that is at the bottom of your screen. Okay, so use your mute while the presentation is happening. And if you want to share something in the chat, just click chat. If you'd like to view closed captions tonight, please click on the CC button to view the live transcript. You can either choose show subtitles or view full transcript. Our sign language interpreters tonight are Julie and Susan from DHI LLC. And I don't know what the acronym means. Next. So to kick us off, I want to introduce Kira Strong, who is the Rebuild Executive Director.
Thank you. Pardon me. Thank you, Donna. This is Kira Strong. I am a white woman. You can't tell because I am sitting now, but fairly tall, and I have brown hair. And most importantly, I am very happy to be here tonight. So just wanted to say a quick welcome and a thank you to all of you for taking the time out of your evenings to be here and to continue to work with us, the Rebuild team, our design team, Digsaw, Ground Reconsidered, our community engagement team, CCB, Parks and Rec, Councilman Jones' office, and the list goes on and on. We have a really terrific team here, and most importantly, you all, to give your time and your feedback to ensure that we are reflecting your needs and desires in the new and re-envisioned Carousel House. So we're really excited tonight to show you what we've heard from you all and for you to let us know if we got it right. So thank you for being here.
Thank you. And now we'd like to have a welcome from the Commissioner of Philadelphia Parks and Rec. Is Catherine here?
I am here. Hi, Donna.
Hi.
Hi. Good evening, everybody. Don't want to take too much time because I know we have a really great agenda, and I'm excited for you all to see these initial plans for the new Carousel House. Really excited for you all to see what this wonderful design team has put together for the future of this great community public space. I really believe that it encompasses all of the great ideas and hopes and dreams that we've heard over the past few years that we've been working on this project and engaging with all of you and many others. And we are excited to hear everybody's feedback and also to most importantly, get this project started. Let's do a groundbreaking and let's start to see shovels in the ground. I know we're still a ways off from that yet because we have to finish the design, but we're getting closer and closer every day. And I can't wait for that day to come. So thank you all so much for taking time out of your schedules to be here this evening and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, Catherine. All right, and do we have anyone from City Council Member Curtis Jones' office here who would like to share some words? Great, we will move on. And so right now I'm going to turn it over to Amanda.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Amanda Colon Smith, and I am the Community Engagement Director with Rebuild. I am an African-American woman, I have glasses and a yellow headband. I'm really excited to see some familiar faces on the call. We are going to share some updates on the project, but for anyone who's new, we'll just do a couple of slides to recap in general about the project. So our focus is on the Carousel House. On your screen, there is an aerial, like bird's eye view of the site, sort of a different way than what we're used to looking at Carousel House. But a lot of the floor plans and site plans you'll see tonight are from this perspective. So if you ever need a moment to stop and ask for orientation, just raise your hand or put something in the chat, come off mute. Because this is the way that we will be looking at the site. Next slide. Project goals. Really here, we are excited to be really creating a wonderful new experience of the Carousel House that retains all of that former programming that was very beloved by the user community, and also to expand it to be inclusive for all participants and welcoming in folks from the East and West Parkside neighborhoods who also participate in this new Carousel House. Rebuild, when we work with every one of our sites across the city, we commit to acknowledging history of the site, to engage the community in design process, and to ensure that when we get ready for that groundbreaking, that we are investing intentionally with really, really strong goals for diverse contracting. Next slide. I do some quick intros of our teams. For those who have not been here, Rebuild is working together with our engagement side, myself, Heather McLean, along with Kara Meadow, who is our senior design and construction project manager. You will see several other Rebuilders on the call tonight and throughout this process. We're all here to support seeing this project through design, in through construction and till the end to getting everyone back into the building. I'm gonna pass the mic to our next partner on the project, Digsaw.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jules Dingle. I'm a white man with relatively short gray hair and a dark sweater and a dark background behind me on Zoom. So I might look like a head floating in space. I want to echo everyone that just spoke's enthusiasm for this project. I speak on behalf of the whole design team, which includes architects, landscape architects, engineers, consultants of many sorts, some of whom are with us tonight. And so I'm going to get right to it and introduce some of them from our team or the architects. There's myself, Jules, Adria, who you'll hear from in a little bit, Rolando, and Sarah. And they will each help us walk through the new facility and show you what design progress we've made. Next, we want to introduce Studio Pacifica. I'm going to hand it off to Karen Breitmeyer because she's here. And if she's not queued up, that's okay. Karen and Studio Pacifica are some of the leading experts in this country, if not in the world, in universal design. There's Karen. Why don't you introduce your team for us?
Sure. Thank you. Studio Pacifica is also thrilled to work on this project, one that has a great history of supporting a wide variety of people, being inclusive, and we want to keep that character. There's myself. I'm a principal, and then Joyce and Kay, who both bring different perspectives to the team. So we're happy to be here and to work with you all.
Thank you, Karen. And lastly, we're going to introduce three members of our team from the landscape architect team. Ground Reconsidered are the landscape architects. We're not going to hear from them tonight, but maybe in the next meeting, we're going to talk about the features of the site in addition to talking about the building. But let me just introduce Julie, Sarah, and James, who you'll meet probably in the next engagement session. And I'm going to pass it off to Jenny, I believe, or Donna, who's next? There we go.
Thanks, Joel. Hi, everyone. My name is Jenny Chen. I use she, her pronouns. I'm an Asian American woman with long black hair, and I'm really excited to be here tonight with Community Capacity Builders, or CCB. Our team is supporting community engagement on the Carousel House Rebuild Project. And besides myself, there's Donna Griffin, who provided the welcome, and Marangeli Mejia-Rebel, or Maggie, who you're going to hear from later this evening. So I'm going to talk about the project timeline. We really got things kicked off a little over a year ago by learning from the Carousel House community and understanding your priorities for the new facility. And last February, we got the design work started with our first workshop and brought you all together to share your ideas about the kinds of spaces and accessible features that should be included. And since then, the design team has been really busy assessing the building, pulling together all your great ideas for the new facility, and coming up with draft proposals that we're going to share tonight for your feedback. And we'll continue refining these designs throughout the year and hosting other workshops and focus groups like this one to get your input so that we're going to be ready to share a final design by this fall or winter. From there, we're going to go into construction, and we anticipate the new facility reopening sometime in 2025. Next, we'll talk about the engagement work we've done and what we've heard so far. So we reached out to more than 1,000 stakeholders to bring folks together for the meet and greet in November 2021. And the kickoff design workshop last February. And during the meet and greet, more than 100 people joined us to learn about the project and share their priorities for how our engagement process should go. And that informed how we ran our kickoff design workshops, where we got to hear directly from more than 120 people, including many on this call. And last summer, we also attended two community events to ask Carousel House and Parkside community members about the history and art and memories that you would like to see reflected in the new facility. And we'll be asking some of those same questions tonight, just in case you didn't have a chance to catch us at one of those events. We also had a chance to share a community update on Zoom last fall to catch you up on the design team's progress. This project has involved a diversity of different stakeholders, including the Carousel House staff, the advisor council, people who participated or led activities and athletic leagues, as well as service providers and advocates in the disability community. We've also involved Parkside organizations, as well as neighborhood institutions, residents, and political leaders. We got over 400 public comments during the kickoff design workshop, and we learned that the basketball court needs to have enough space for accessible seating and for players to transition between games. We talked about the new indoor pool, and people were really excited about using it for things like therapy, classes, and recreation. We heard there's a need for spacious and accessible locker rooms and bathrooms, as well as flexible multi-purpose rooms. Finally, we found out that storage was key for things like sports chairs, personal belongings, and equipment. So I'm going to pass it now to Kira Strong from Rebuild to talk about the project resources to meet these priorities.
Thanks, Jenny. You can go ahead and advance to the next slide if you can. I think folks, Jenny just shared what we had heard was on the wish list and the need list for everyone who uses this facility. And part of the challenge for all of us and the tension has been our budget not necessarily matching those needs. And so when we met last September with many of you, we asked for your support and your help in advocating for additional funds for a state grant opportunity. And a number of you submitted letters of support for the project, and thank you very much. It helped us be successful in that application. And we were awarded $1 million through the state, it's called RACP, the grant. So that was terrific. And we owe you a big thanks. And then other really, really, really good news, which is absolutely impacted the slides that you'll see next. The mayor, through the petitioning, I think, and the advocacy of many of you through Parks and Rec, through Rebuild and others, has prioritized supporting the improvements that you all have made very clear you need in this new facility. So we are looking at upwards of $30 million, $35 million, exact amount still to be determined, but a very considerable commitment to this facility and really around the needs that you all articulated. So I just wanted to share that good news on behalf of all of us and to pass it back to the design team for them to give you an update on taking that input and now that support, what that could look like.
Hey, hello everyone. I, along with others from the design team, will now talk through community-driven design for the building. My name is Adria Longenderber. I use she, her pronouns and am a white woman with blonde hair and freckles and am wearing a dark shirt. I'm very excited to kick off this portion of the presentation where we dive into more detail about what you can expect from the new facility. We've heard that the community wants a new facility to serve many different types of programs which need both big and small spaces. Since we've last met, it was determined that the existing building's foundation or the bones of the building are still functional in many ways and can be reused as part of a new larger facility that serves all of the programs and types of spaces that the Carousel House and Parkside communities want. The project will use something called adaptive reuse to expand upon the existing foundation and create new program spaces, including a new gym and a new pool. By doing this, we're acknowledging the history of this very important site and building upon what is best in the current Carousel House. After studying the existing building, the design team, which is a group of architects, designers, and engineers, concluded that the Carousel House building and site are great candidates for adaptive reuse. So what is adaptive reuse? It's not an accessibility term, even though it may sound like it. It's actually an architectural term that describes taking an existing building and updating it. So for this project, it means that we'll do a gut rehab of the facility where older interiors, finish elements, furniture, systems like lighting, heating, cooling, and bathrooms are removed, but the foundations and structurally safe bones of the building, if you will, are saved. The idea is to take existing well-used spaces that are in need of TLC but have good bones that might look like the room in the top photo on the screen and transform them into fresh new spaces like the room in the bottom photo. Adaptive reuse will help us make the best use of our resources and allow us to maximize available dollars in the new portion of the build and double the size of the building footprint. This image shows an overview of the proposed site plan. In the plan, you can see the new gym is located along Belmont Avenue, and the new pool is located along Avenue of the Republic. We're keeping most of the parking along the eastern edge of the site, which is screened right, and it'll have a dedicated drop-off close to the new building entry. This new front door will be closer to South Concourse Drive than in the current facility. We're also keeping most of the beautiful old growth trees, which are currently a key feature of the outdoor areas of the site. Today, we're going to focus on the inside of the building, but we'll circle back with you and the rest of the community to discuss the site elements in greater detail at a future meeting. And next, we'll go into detail of the building, what it includes, and where all the spaces are located. So this slide shows the proposed spaces inside the building. The building will be a single level facility, so there won't be any level changes, no stairs, no ramps or elevators. Every threshold will be low and all the doors will be a minimum of 48 inches wide. And most spaces will have an abundant access to natural light through windows and skylights. We've organized the location of the spaces in the building and which spaces are next to each other based on things we've heard from you all and from other stakeholders, based on where features of the existing building that we'd like to keep, like existing skylights, are located, and based on grouping spaces that want to be next to each other, like the pool and the locker rooms, or separating spaces that may not want to be next to each other for sound privacy, for example, like the fitness and sensory rooms. I'm going to hand it over to my colleagues now, and we're going to take you on a tour of the building and zoom into each of these rooms into more detail over the next series of slides. And as Jenny previously mentioned, as we go along, we'll be asking you questions to keep in mind and think about, break into our groups for smaller discussions. So Jules, I'll hand it over to you now.
Thank you, Adria. As Adria mentioned, the new entrance will now be on the south side. Formerly at the Carousel House, the entry was on the north, and we think it's important to move it to the south side, one, to make a welcoming gesture to the south side, South Parkside and West Parkside community, as well as to create a new covered drop-off so that people that are arriving by CCT or a caregiver in a vehicle can exit their car undercover. And that drop-off area will have an exterior covered canopy that doubles also as a multi-purpose outdoor space where maybe small groups of kids from the playground may gather, or it could be used for other outdoor functions. Upon entering the room, as you'll see on the left, which is just a partial plan of the building, there'll be a staffed reception desk. And then what you see in green nearby, just beyond the staffed reception desk, will be the staff office, where the rec leader will have clear visibility over what's going on in the facility. We heard from you that it was important to have waiting areas inside the building so that when people are waiting for their CCT or caregiver to pick them up, there's a comfortable place to sit with good visibility of what's outside. We've also heard that it's important to have a bathroom near the entry. That's something we're continuing to work on. Let's go to the next slide and we'll look at the reuse of what was formerly the basketball court. So the idea here is that since we're adding two basketball courts in the new facility, that the old basketball court space can be remade into a bright, multi-use, spacious, light-filled room that could be easily reconfigured for a variety of purposes. It also provides a central point in the building where rec staff and visitors to the building are clearly able to see the features and program of the building, all from this central location. This room will be easily reconfigurable. We imagine that by day, it may be small groups gathering for, say, chess club, but at night there may be a large community event or a table and chair dinner. We've heard that the spaces in this building need to be as welcoming as possible. And a big part of that is providing both large gathering spaces and a variety of smaller spaces where people can gather. Flexibility is, of course, essential. So reusing the old basketball court as a multi-purpose space with flexible furniture will allow us to do quite a bit in this space, even while the gym is being used for sports. We've also heard that large indoor space is really needed in this community for civic events and meetings, and this space will accommodate that as well. Lastly, we heard that it was important to have zero or very few hallways so that the building was easy to understand, that it was safe and easy for navigation, including for service animals. When we go into the breakout rooms, we'd like you to think about what are the kind of events that you could imagine, both large and small, having it happening in a big centralized space like this. Let's move on to the new basketball gym, which I should say is...
Jules, we're actually going to pause at this slide. So we're going to use polls in Zoom as another way to get feedback from you all as we go through each of these different spaces. And if you see a little blue star at the bottom of the slide, that means you can expect a poll question. So
yes.
The first one is going to be about the atrium. Oh, I'm sorry. And the question is, what is an activity you could imagine doing in this space? And you can select your top three, please. And the options are participating in a community meeting, attending a dinner, going to a dance, hanging out and relaxing, watching a movie, attending an open mic night or a play, playing table or video games, or something else. And you can always share that something else in the chat. We'll give folks about a minute to respond, and then we'll keep it moving. All right, last 10 seconds for this question. And you'll always have a chance in your breakout room discussions to share your thoughts about this question and others, just in case you didn't get a chance to respond to the poll. Thanks. I'll turn it back now to Jules.
All right, thank you. It's exciting to see the poll populating and also to see a wide range of interest for that space, which we think it can certainly handle a variety of activities. Similarly, the gym is now a much larger gym, a gym that has two basketball courts and a divider in the middle so that two basketball games could happen simultaneously, but also other sports as well. And we want to hear about that from you when we get out into the breakout discussions. We'd like to know what other sports or events you think would be well suited in a gymnasium that's now almost twice the size of the Carousel House gym that you're familiar with. We've heard that it's very important that a space like this have a dedicated space for specialized equipment. In particular, wheelchair basketball requires extra space for sports chairs. So we are showing courts that have jumbo size sidelines so that can be accommodated. We've also heard that it's very important to have dedicated space for storage of the specialized equipment. Not just wheelchairs for basketball, but other equipment as well. And we'd like to hear from you in the discussion about the type of equipment, the type of features, and the type of activities in this space that would make it most appealing and useful to you.
Great, and we have a poll for the gym as well. And the question for you all is, besides basketball, another sport I might like to play in the gym is, and you can type in a short answer. And we'll give folks about a minute on this. Great, we're going to wrap that one up. And again, you can think about this question and prepare for the discussion in the breakout rooms, the second half of this meeting. For now, I'll turn it back to Rolando.
Hi, everybody. My name is Rolando Lopez. I am a Hispanic male. I have dark hair. And I'm wearing a blue and white checkered shirt today. So next up, we're going to be talking about the pool. The pool is accessed through a corridor just north of the multipurpose atrium that Jules was just describing. This room will have two separate pools. The one closer to the entry is the activity pool. This pool will be zero entry and will be 3'6" deep at the maximum end. The further pool from the entry is the lap pool. This pool will go up from 4 feet to 8 feet and will be available for exercise and lifeguard training. We plan on including a barrier between the two pools to protect anyone who may accidentally head towards the deeper lap pool. Both pools will have lifts for chair transfer in and out, and the sides of the pool will have ample space for wheelchairs, seating, and circulation. The design also includes a wet classroom for families and caregivers to watch activity, and also for some portions of lifeguard training. We heard that the deck of the pool should be oversized to accommodate swim gear and should include high grip, high contrast flooring. We also heard that there's a need for a lot of storage for toys, floaties, water chairs, and lap lanes, which will be accommodated in a storage room. A question we want you to think about for our breakout rooms is, where do you put your swim gear when you're swimming? And we will now go to a poll question.
Thanks, Orlando. The question we have for you all about the pool is, what other features could make the pool feel more safe and inclusive? And we ask that you choose your top three. And the options are safety signage, anti-slip floor coating, handrails at the zero entry ramp, places to store belongings on the pool deck, adjustable lighting, dedicated areas for families, caregivers and or children, and something else. And you can always put that something else in the chat as well. All right, we'll give about 15 more seconds on this question. Great, thank you. And I'll turn it back to Rolando.
Alrighty. So next up, we're going to be talking about the locker rooms and restrooms. These rooms are located adjacent to the pool. They're also adjacent to the multipurpose atrium. The locker rooms include toilets and sinks, in addition to showers, changing areas, and places to store personal items during swim. The design includes men's, women's, and two gender-neutral family changing rooms with shower and toilet facilities. The locker rooms have direct access to the pool deck. We heard that the lockers should include room for back benches for transferring, as well as adult-sized changing tables. And we also heard that gender-neutral and family shower rooms should be as close as possible to the pool deck. A question we want you to think about in the breakout is, who are you most likely to visit the locker room with, and how does that impact your use of that space? And we will now go to a question.
Great. So the question we have for you all about the locker rooms is, what other features can make the locker rooms as accessible and functional as possible? And please choose your top three. So the options are benches at different heights, lockers at different heights, anti-slip floor coating, wayfinding signage or floor materials, additional mirrors, adaptive locker hardware, dedicated private changing areas, and something else. All right, we'll give a few more seconds to this poll. Thanks to everyone who responded, and I'll turn it back now to Rolando.
Okay, so we're showing this slide again of the overall building plan to refresh everyone on the spaces that we have just looked at. So we have looked at the entry, the atrium, the gym, the pool, and the locker rooms. Next up, we're going to be going over medium-sized spaces, starting with the fitness room. The fitness room will have plenty of room for machines and clearances around equipment, and will include a stretching zone, a strength zone, and a cardio zone. Right now, we are planning for hand bikes, stationary bikes, treadmill, rowing machine, universal machine, and weights. We're also looking to reuse some of the existing features of the carousel house in this room, and we'll have large windows looking out into the landscape, as well as a nice skylight. We heard that an ideal fitness room includes plenty of room to pass by machines and transfer in and out of a chair. A question we want you to think about is, what types of exercise do you like to do in a fitness room? And I will now hand it over to Sarah.
Thanks, Rolando. And hi, everyone. My name is Sarah Curry. I'm with Digsaw. My pronouns are she, her. I'm a Black woman wearing glasses and a dark shirt, and I have really curly hair. The art and ceramics room is a medium-sized room that's going to be used for different types of crafts and will have plenty of storage. For those of you who are familiar with the current carousel house, we'll be putting the kiln in its own room, which will be much more safe, and it increases the amount of space to move around. Outside of the windows, you'll be able to see views of the gorgeous trees outside, as well as the rest of Fairmount Park. J. Jenny, what's our poll question for this slide?
Thanks, Sarah. Give me 1 second. Here we go. So for the art and ceramics room, what other features or equipment are needed in the art and ceramics room? And again, please choose your top three. Options are chairs and tables with wheels, dimmable lights and adjustable window shades, accessible height sinks, high efficiency ventilation for art supply odors, display cases or other ways to hang up artwork, or something else. And you can share that in the chat. We'll give another 10 seconds for this poll. All right, and we can share results. Here, I'll check out. Thanks, okay. Go ahead.
And thanks everyone for filling out all of these polls. Next up, we have the sensory room. We've heard that the sensory room is a necessary space as both a place where people can calm down, where it's quiet, and also a place where those who are seeking sensory experiences can find them. The sensory room will include soft furniture, kinetic toys, dimmable lighting, and sensory tools. There will also likely be a small table with chairs in it in case individual private meetings need to occur. There's also a poll question for the sensory room.
Great, our question is, what items could be included in the sensory room to help people calm down, gain energy, or find privacy? And you can choose your top three. The options are dimmable lights and adjustable window shades, soft furniture, swings, wiggle chairs or medicine balls, soft play items, books and quiet games, or something else. I'm seeing some great recommendations included in the chat too, so please keep doing that. All right, we'll keep this one open for about 10 more seconds. All right, thank you everyone who participated in that poll. Check out the results, and I'll pass it back to Sarah.
Thanks, Jenny. Now we're looking at the kitchen. The kitchen is located between the gym and the multipurpose atrium for easy access to prepared food and concessions during large events. On a daily basis, though, this kitchen will include residential appliances and will primarily be used by staff. The computer lab will have workstations for open use and also for computer-based classes. The lab will also include adaptive equipment like adjustable height desks and other assistive technology and softwares. This room will have plenty of outlets and will work to reduce glare as much as possible. And we've got a poll question.
Our question is, what would you use the computer lab for? You can choose your top three. Would you use it to take a class, play video games, check email and social media accounts, do schoolwork or study, job searching, entrepreneurship or small business, video call with friends and family, or is there something else? Great. We'll give us about 10 more seconds. And we can check out the results. Like a lot of learners out there. It's very cool. All right, Sarah, I'll turn it back to you.
Thanks. Moving into the multi-purpose rooms, as you can imagine, these rooms could be used for virtually anything, whether that's meetings, music, different classes, therapy, or again, anything you could think of. There's a divider down the middle to divide the space into two smaller spaces, or it could be removed for one large space. And this is one of our favorite rooms because we're reusing the existing skylights and keeping them there. Time for another poll question.
All right, this is our second to last poll question. So what features or equipment could help make the multi-purpose room a flexible space? Please choose your top three. They include flexible divider wall, chairs and tables with wheels, projectors, whiteboards, dimmable lights and adjustable window shades, flexible audiovisual equipment, or something else. We'll give 10 more seconds on this one. All right, and we're gonna close this poll out and share the results. Our last poll is actually about the outside look of the look and feel of the building and also about the proposed spaces. For a closing poll question, there's actually two. So the first question is, which physical design elements on the outside of the existing Carousel House would you want to see in the new facility? And for this one, we asked you to choose your top two. The options are a covered drop-off canopy by the entry, the lattice or other decorative band around the building, round shape, skylights, or windows to views of Fairmount Park. The second question asks, how do you feel about the following statement? There's a space for me in the new facility where I can participate in activities and enjoy being with family and friends. And you can choose from strongly agree to strongly disagree, or if you're unsure. We'll give folks a little more time because there's two questions here.
Can't see the second question.
Okay, if you try scrolling down on the little window that's popped up, does that help?
It doesn't because I'm on my phone.
Oh, okay. If you would like to answer that question in the chat, feel free. And I'll repeat it as folks are wrapping up the poll. How do you feel about the following statement? There's a space for me in the new facility where I can participate in activities and enjoy being with family and friends. And Bridget, the options are strongly agree, agree, neutral, disagree, strongly disagree, or unsure. Feel free to respond in the chat. I'm sorry, that's not showing up for you. All right, thank you all so much for participating in these many, many polls. And we'll also be going into breakout sessions shortly after our Q&A. Marangeli?
Good afternoon. Good evening, folks. My name is Marangeli Mejia Ravel. You can also call me Maggie. And I'm a Puerto Rican woman with chin length hair and my favorite bamboo silver earrings. And I have a tie-dye blue, white and blue sweater. And I'm part of the Community Capacity Builders team. And we're going to have a 10-minute Q&A space for general questions before we go into our breakout sessions. You can either raise your hand and speak, or you can also, if you feel that it's easier to share questions via chat, you can also do that. And
hi, are we waiting for questions? Because I have a question.
Yeah, you can ask your question now, sir.
This is Michael Anderson from the Ark of Philadelphia. Do you know the hours of the Carousel House? What would the hours be?
Thank you, Michael. Do we know what the question is? Do we know what the hours of the new Carousel House facility will be?
I think if someone, yeah, Kira or maybe yep. Gwen, this, I see from PPR.
This is Kira. I don't think, I think Catherine from PPR stepped off for the moment. Michael, I don't think we know yet the exact hours, but we can certainly look into that and come back to you.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you so much. Thank you, Kira and Amanda. Do we have another question?
Leonette has a question.
Leonette, go ahead. Thank you so much, Lana.
Hi, good evening, everybody. Thank you so much. My first question is, could you, and I'm sorry if I missed it, could you tell me what the square footage of this new Carousel House building will be?
No.
Okay, so question on the floor is the square footage of the new facility?
Yes.
Square footage. Thank you, Leonette.
No, mute.
Okay, mute. Right?
I'm going to put the design team on the spot. Hey, we know the exact square footage or close to square footage.
Of it. Put it on.
The current design is about 54,000 square feet. And Sarah Rolando, chime in if that is not accurate.
If it's not accurate, it's okay. I just wanted to get an average. And if you guys can send that in an email, that'd be great as well. Just interested in doing some comparison. So thank you so much for that information. I would definitely look forward to that accuracy soon. My second question is surrounding the director of inclusion. One of the biggest concerns going into this project was people with disabilities losing recreation sites where they feel comfortable and taking, you know, special need programs and things of that nature. So what is being done right now from the Director of Inclusion and other park and recreation sites since losing the Carousel House?
Hi, Leonette. I can take that question, Maggie. Hi, Leonette. My name is Bumbleade. I'm the Director of Inclusion for Parks and Recreation. So we are working across our sites across the city, providing training for our staff to welcome and include individuals with disabilities in their sites. We have summer day camp and after school programs at a lot of our recreation sites. We're also offering some specialized programs such as sensory friendly hours at some of our different facilities that have special things like ice rinks and pools. And we also have been able to expand some of our inventory of accessible pool lifts to make some of our pools more accessible. And we'll have more of those to add to that list this summer. So those are just a couple of quick examples. We're also working with internal partners, our rec leaders and staff throughout PPR to move more inclusion initiatives forward, as well as external partners, Special Olympics, different external partners. We hope to continue to spread that throughout the city, and also, you know, maintain and build on the programming that was offered at Carousel House previously. Maintain all of that programming and, hopefully be able to offer even more.
Thank you, Wynn. So I want to give an opportunity to Lisa, who has a question. And then from there, I'm going to go to three questions that I have via chat. Lisa, go ahead. Thanks, Wynn.
Am I Lisa?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
That's what I'm seeing. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, okay. I can go by that. That's fine. Quick question, just out of my pure curiosity. One of the pools is zero entry. Why are not both pools zero entry?
Thank you for that.
Everybody can access it.
Thanks.
Sure. And Rollo can maybe add more detail regarding the pool, but there will be lifts in the lap pool, because that pool will also be used for lifeguard training and lap swimming. And so the ability to do traditional lap swimming to both ends is, in this case, we think best accommodated by having lifts for the lap pool and then zero entry for the leisure pool.
Didn't even think of that. Makes perfect sense. Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to go to one of the questions in the chat that comes to us from Beth Licken. And it's, how is the safety of the disabled population while in attendance? Will programs for the general public override the usage of the building for this special population? That is the question on the floor.
When is that something, Wynn? Sorry to put you on the spot. That's something you would want to answer, or as someone else from PPR?
Thank you, Ms. Beth.
Sorry, Maggie, can you just?
I'm going to repeat the question. The question is around safety. I'm going to read it again. How is the safety of the disabled population basically being protected while in attendance, or addressed while in attendance? Will programs for the general public override the usage of the building for the special population?
Thank you. Safety is our priority in any of our buildings. And we understand the concerns of the disability community surrounding safety. There is a history in our country and society of maybe some not so great experiences for people with disabilities. And we recognize that. And what we're doing right now is looking to try to bring groups together to build a culture that's built on respect, trust, and belonging, and continue to also, put into our community that it's a zero tolerance policy for bullying or disrespect or any of those things. Our aim is to be welcoming, to people with disabilities, to be welcoming to the community, and to be able to bring these groups together so that we can all recreate together as humans and respect each other. So we're gonna do a lot of hard work to build that community and build that that trust among the groups and the users. And we'll also sit down as a staff and look at the scheduling of the building, the different rooms, the different groups, and really carefully look at what what is best and what makes sense for everybody.
Oh, thank you, Wynn. So I have a request from Lynette that is asking.
I saw it. Yeah, I'll put my email right now.
Very good. Thank you so much. And then there is a comment from Ms. Bev, which is, why is the lab pool even included? Most of the special population can become lifeguards. There is the, and then there's the mention of the other pool. And we have right now, thank you for dropping your email. And we have 3 minutes. Do we have any additional questions?
Hi, it's Michael again. I have some concerns about the gymnasium. How will sound barriers be put up if people don't want to hear the noise of a game and there's more than one game going on? Will there be sound barriers and so on and so forth? Sometimes it might be too chaotic or too loud.
Michael.
Will there be sound barriers? What will there be?
Thank you, Mike. So the question on the floor has to do with the capacity of the gymnasium and activity and how will that be monitored to make sure that it doesn't become chaotic. Is that capturing your question, Mike?
Yeah, and will there be sound barriers?
Would it be soundproof?
Yeah.
Okay, so capacity in terms of the amount of people that are engaging in activity at one time and how will that be managed? And,
yeah, and sometimes there might be two kids and there might be too much noise going on. Or what will happen if people don't want to hear noise of two kids?
Okay, so there's also the element of, are we soundproofing that space to then create a barrier for other users of the facility?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Mike. Jules, you want to take that?
Sure. Thank you, Mike, for that question. Currently in the design, we are looking at acoustical metal deck in the ceiling and acoustical block on the walls, all of which help absorb sound. But I think you're raising this concern is very important for the design team to hear because we want to do everything we can to make sure that this goes above and beyond the acoustical treatments that would be in maybe a conventional gym. So thank you for that question. We'll make sure we pay extra attention to that.
Yes, because what if I just want to hear the noise of my game and not the other game? It might be too noisy or they might not be able to hear the referees or whatever because it's too much noise from the other game.
Understood. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Jules, and thank you, Mike. Any other questions? We are at 6:39 now, so we have room for one more, if anything. If not, we'll move to our breakout rooms. Friendly reminder that questions that are captured via chat, the recording of the session, as well as the presentation, will be made available via the project's website, Carousel House Reveal.
Maggie, I saw Roseanne maybe had her physical hand up in her video, but I don't know if she can still squeeze
in. I'm sorry, I only saw, thank you, Amanda.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, do you want to come in and ask a question? Amanda has brought to our attention that there's a hand up. Go ahead, Miss. You need to unmute yourself. Thank
Hello.
You.
Can you hear Hi. Me now?
Absolutely, Miss. How are you?
Okay. My name's Roseanne Curlin, and I'm with the Katie Curlin Fund, Wheelchair Basketball. Since the house is supposed to be 70% for the disabled and 30% for the community, how will the scheduling go? Suppose on a Monday or Tuesday night, the wheelchair basketball or the rugby usually practices, and then a team from the community wanted to come in. How is it going to, who's going to be able to control the scheduling, I guess, for the disabled and the non-disabled community?
I believe that's a Parks and Rec question when, and I know you addressed scheduling earlier and dialogue, but if you want to go in before we close it out.
Yeah, I think, you know, when we determine all the groups that are interested in using the building, we will look at those who use the building before and find out what their preference is. Are they going to be using with the same frequency? As well as, you know, what are the desires of this new community? And sit down and really balance that out as a Parks and Rec staff, you know, along with our program managers and our senior staff to help us advise, you know, what makes the most sense for everybody. But I'm really excited about the expansion of the building and the extra space, because I think it's just going to make it so much easier for lots more people to come together at Carousel.
Okay, because before the Carousel House was 100% for the disabled. So that'll be really important to take all their needs into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you both. And at this point, if there are any additional questions, please feel free to fill them, to share them via chat, and we'll make sure to incorporate them. But it is the time to move into our breakout design stations. Thank you for your participation.
Thanks, Marangeli, appreciate it. And thank you everybody for your participation in the poll questions and the great chat suggestions you've made, as well as asking some very important questions. We want you to know that your feedback is very important in this process. And to help us engage you more in conversation, we're going to enter you into our breakout room. So there'll be, I believe, five breakout rooms with a Carousel House Rebuild team member and a note taker. And pretty much we're going to be engaging you about all of the information you just heard regarding the Carousel House site plan, the overall building plan, and the proposed program spaces. So now's an opportunity to share more of your thoughts and get some really good feedback from you in a more intimate setting. All right, so I think we're ready.
Great, I'm gonna let folks into their breakout rooms. At any point, if you have a question for Rebuild or for Parks and Rec in general, feel free to return to the main room, and Kira and Catherine and other folks from the team will be here. Thanks.
Good evening. This is Marangeli again. Thank you for participating in the breakout rooms. I just want to close the session talking about our next steps. So for those of you, please, 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 for everybody, please ask friends to sign up for the Carousel House Rebuild newsletter and check out project updates on the website, which we were just talking on our breakout room. So I'm glad to have the opportunity, which is carouselhouserebuild.org. Carouselhouserebuild.org. Complete the evaluation survey to let us know what you think about the design and engagement process at the Rebuild site. Check out your email next week for a recording of this meeting. A copy of the presentation will also be in the website, and stay tuned for our next design workshop this summer. And as we continue with the site and building plans continue to evolve, and we thank you for making the time to join us this evening, and please enjoy the rest of your evening. And I wanna thank our partners that provided interpretation, and thank you so much for making the time. You can also stay in touch with the Rebuild team. On your screen, you have Amanda Colon Smith's email, amanda.colon-smith@fila.gov or rebuild@fila.gov. And community capacity builders, Donna Griffin, Donna at ccbconsult.org, or Jenny Chen at Jenny at ccbconsult.org. Once again, thank you for your time and enjoy the rest of your evening. We look forward to connecting with you soon.